Shahnaaz, and as Shahnaaz indicated, we thought that it would be useful and really important to be able to harness the kinds of experiences and wisdoms of a set of past presidents. These are, of course, not the only past presidents. There are a number of past presidents here as well. But we thought that it would be exceptionally helpful to us to harness the insights and the experiences of past presidents as we think about this debate and some of the elements that Shahnaaz has just raised now. So as indicated, the theme of the panel is really looking back, looking forward. We've asked participants to draw from their specific contributions to PsySSA and the distinguishing vision for the society during their terms as PsySSA presidents and their officers, and invite them to share their thoughts and perspectives on key PsySSA developments and challenges over the last 25 years, as well as the priority imperatives for PsySSA in the 25 years to follow. Each panelist will be allocated a maximum of 10 minutes, and we'll simply let them run on one after the other to consider the most salient elements that of course of concern to PsySSA during their terms. But they're also critical and of value to South African society, how these were dealt with, or sometimes not sufficiently dealt with, and what they see as the key issues facing psychology and PsySSA as we enter the next phase of the organization's life and our country's future. So I want to turn very briefly to introduce all of our panelists very quickly. I'm not going to read out all of their extensive histories, biographies, and CVs, but in order from your left to right, and this is the order in which they want to speak. Professor Anthony Pillay, who is a professor at Nelson Mandela School of Medicine at the University of KwaZulu-Natal, who is the PsySSA past president from 2015 to 2016. Professor Kopano, Ratele, who is a professor at the Institute of Social and Health Sciences, University of South Africa, PsySSA past president 2009 to 2010. Dr. Anne Watts, current Secretary General of the International Union of Psychological Sciences, PsySSA past president 2000 to 2002. Professor Sats Cooper, past president of the International Union of Psychological Sciences, 2018 to 2020, also president of the Pan-African Psychology Union, and also PsySSA past president 2006 to 2007, but of course much earlier in its history, 1996 to 1999 as well. And then finally, we have Professor Sumaya Lahair, who is a professor in the Department of Psychology at the University of the Witwatersrand, who is the PsySSA past president 2016 to 2017. So colleagues, I'm going to ask you all perhaps to just share your thoughts with us for 10 minutes each. And we're going to hold you quite strictly to time because we do want to engage the audience and really have the audience engage you and pick your brains about both the past and the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Garth and Shahnaaz. I'm not sure if it's a good thing or a bad thing to have to go first. But for me, perhaps the first thing I want to reflect on is my own reasons for having joined PsySSA. And it certainly wasn't because I was wanting PsySSA to do something for me. I think anything that I had to do in the development of my career, I had to and should do myself. I think I joined PsySSA for two reasons. One is because of a need to belong to a broader, organized psychology discipline, academic body that could serve, could take up initiatives, but all in the aim of serving our nation. The other was to try to contribute in some little way. And so those really were my my intentions in joining PsySSA. In the course of my presidency in the 2015-2016 period, which is what we were each asked to reflect on, there were a number of things that came up, but there are two that particularly seemed relevant to look at. The one was we had the scope of practice issue that came up in a very big way. course, that's a very significant issue. I must apologize in advance, because some of what we're talking about may not be understood by our foreign guests, but hopefully in the course of the day we can explain some of these local issues. But the scope of practice issue did affect a number of our colleagues, and certainly it's an issue that should be looked at, and I have absolutely no problem with that. But the problem that I did have was that it tended to subsume the entire organization. And that, I think, was problematic. It was an injustice to all the other people, members, etc. I don't think we must do things in that way. I think there must certainly be attempts to look at these issues. These are very serious issues because they affect people's livelihoods, people's incomes. We must look at it. But at the same time, I do think science must be the organization where it can handle various things at one time. The other issue that came up during that time was the live acidomany, and that is where I think it was about 3 months into my presidency, and we found out that the Department of Health in Gauteng, in this province, was planning to discharge large numbers, very large numbers, chronic mentally ill patients who've been in hospitals for years. And we know through experiences around the world where what this kind of deinstitutionalization plans have resulted in. We at that time did communicate with the MEC for Health. The letter that I've written at that time is on the website. Did we do enough? I've asked myself that question since then. Well, over 140 people died. Over 140 mentally ill people died in a very short space of time after that deinstitutionalization. So the answer to that question, did we do enough, has to be no. We as PsySSA, me as the president at the time, all of the other mental health and other healthcare associations, bodies in the country, the nation, we didn't. Which brings me to my thinking about where we must take psychology. I do believe that in the 25 years that PsySSA has been in existence, a lot has been achieved. And it's what keeps me a member of PsySSA. I'm proud to be a member of PsySSA. Did PsySSA in the 25 years achieve all that it set out to do? Did it achieve all that founding people set on the agenda? Well, perhaps not. But then I don't think any organization or institution will do that. But I believe it's achieved a lot. It's come a huge distance from pre-1994. And for that, I certainly am very pleased to continue my membership with PsySSA. But what about going forward? I think in a very simple vision for me, we need to broaden our view of PsySSA. We need to broaden our vision for psychology in general. We must always remember that only a proportion of psychology professionals in this country actually belong to PsySSA. But I do believe that we need to look at our role in the country in a much broader way. And what do I mean by that? Well, I think we need to develop a more social justice psychology. In other words, a psychology that's not only going to focus on our needs. Obviously, it must. This is our organization, it's our professional association. We must focus on the needs and development and aspirations of our members, but also of our discipline. But I think we owe, and given that in a country with currently very serious economic problems, we as the intelligentsia in the country, we as the relatively more privileged in the country,
we really ought to be looking at what we're going to be doing for our nation. And that is why I think we must have a social justice system. I want to just look at one or two examples here in this context. In the context of what we should be doing outside of our narrow view of psychology. And the one that has bothered me for several years is that of our school system. We've got amazing schools in this country. Very, very high tech, produce amazing results, but that's for the rich. We've also got schools in our country where, as I was thinking this morning before coming here around 7 o'clock, there were probably mothers or caregivers or grandmothers sending children off to schools in certain parts of this country and saying to them, whatever you do, don't go to the toilet today or tomorrow in the school. Our guests, again, may be a little confused, and I'm happy to explain this later. Why? Because you may die in that moment. We have a situation in some schools, in some parts of our country, where children are dying in the pit toilets, in schools. We have to ask why, 25 years after we got rid of apartheid, children are dying in this way. Are we still going to blame apartheid for it? I'm very big on blaming apartheid for lots of things, so don't get me wrong. But I don't think we have sufficient grounds to lay this one there. What has our present government done? Now, the child going to school, a developing being, is that in our area of expertise? Yes, child development, that is our area. It is our department. What have we done? Well, actually, we've been quite silent. This is so sad. And our silence has been interpreted by the relevant education department as accepted. So, I'm going to finish off quickly. We need to stop the silence. We need to be more of an activist psychology. We need to be more of a social justice psychology. It's like the issue with xenophobia in our country. You've heard a little bit this morning. The UNESCO report, 2019 report, released just a few months ago, said that our current school curriculum is not doing enough to educate our children about xenophobia. These are people who come across our borders for no other reason than to get a decent life for themselves and their families. They really did not come here to steal our life. So, we need to, as psychology professionals, we need to get involved. We need to be activists. If we need to go and protest outside the education department, I will join. And if we did that to prevent children dying in school toilets, I would have felt that I made a bigger contribution on that day than in the last close to 40 years in my career. Thank you.
Good morning, Garth. Yes, I should stay where I am, which is good for me. The two things that dominated my tenure as president, one was the Society of Industrial and Organizational Psychologists of South Africa and the Forum of African Psychology. The eventuality of this is that both left the fold of PsySSA. I want to say that in both cases, it is my view that this was the beginning of what I see as will accelerate to the future and might lead to the death of PsySSA. It is always sad, however, whatever reasons you have for somebody leaving you, for loss, that we have to mourn that. It is I wish I had the wisdom of Solomon, biblical wisdom, to have handled that better than we did, but I have no idea how we could have done better. Let me talk about FAP in particular. I was told I agreed during my chamber because I was saying, comrades, why would you do this during my tenure? Why would you want to leave science like during my tenure? As somebody who defines himself as a political, as a critical, as an African-centered psychologist. Well, they didn't at that moment during that year, but they would subsequently do that. And I'm looking at them, so maybe, so let me say this. There are a lot of things I would say about, particularly how we could have, again, handled both COPSA and FAP. Now I'm going to concentrate on FAP before I move quickly to the future. I share much of the vision of what FAP was trying to push PsySSA to do, to be boldly African-centered in the work, in the conferences, and all of that. And there's some things that I don't share, of course. But particularly because I was in my early 20s when I went to the first conference in the human sciences, the first conference of PsySSA, together with Amin Ahmed. Somebody close to me as well was there during that year, so we were young. And so, right from get-go, I had thrown my lot with PsySSA because of the political vision that they have, the vision to unite psychologists, to be inclusive, and all the goals that you know about PsySSA. So I wanted FAP to share, and some of the members of the Forum of African Psychologists are here, to share the vision and to work to create the kind of psychology and the psychology association that FAP wanted PsySSA to be. But now that has happened, and I remain sad about that. Now, I want to say three things for the future connected to this, to partly to this loss. When I was president, and now I'm in a position as a nominations chair, which I might step down from, as my term has come to an end. When I came into the union, to the society, I didn't quite understand how PsySSA works. I think this view is shared by many young psychologists and students about what PsySSA does, and Helen has shared some of this, what psychology, society, psychological society of South Africa does for psychology, for the rest of us. It was only after I left my career that I became clear about the possibilities of PsySSA. And from this point then, I jump two points. The simplest one is this, and we have shared with some of the presidents here on this panel, that we have to prepare a pipeline of leadership. We have, especially of young psychologists and students, well before time. We have spoken about the Leadership Academy, which must be ongoing, annual, so to prepare people who might take up positions in council, in the executive, in other roles, in PsySSA. Because to come in as to ask people who have observed or watched PsySSA as members, as ordinary members, young and not so young, to assume positions of leadership without a long period of induction, if you will, of training about where this might go, is to ask a little bit much of it. So I think this is a really important idea to put on the table for ourselves about how you prepare a young cadre to assume leadership positions in PsySSA. Even the African National Congress has realized that if you don't want to recycle leadership, you have to do this. You have to have, for them it's a political school, ours will be a psychological school. The second point then, leading from this misunderstanding of, inadequate understanding of PsySSA does is this, and this is an important one, which I will mention again later on in the AGM. I am now more convinced than ever that we are in an urgent need of some organizational redesign of PsySSA. When PsySSA was born, it was born because of one vision, one main vision. This was to unite black and white, particularly black and white psychologists in the country. And when CEOPSA and FAP left us, it's because this vision is not as strong as it was pre-1992. And it's clear, again, because of contradictions, really. In one sense, people who define themselves in particular ways as African and African-centered psychology to be at the center of PsySSA says PsySSA is not African-centered enough, although our strategic framework is trying to bring this in. CEOPSA was saying, for whatever reason, and sometimes kind of covert understanding of race, that PsySSA perhaps is blacks, black-dominated, is not serving them. To be more specific then, in this organizational redesign, you want to optimize the operational model between the executive and the administrative structures of PsySSA. To be more specific, I will propose later on that we have to think again about the term of the presidency and key executive officers of PsySSA. And as I said, I've said this perhaps 10 years ago, and 5 years ago I've said this again, but we have to think about this a little bit more. So I would suggest two issues under this. That we're doing this for two reasons. The first reason, somebody wrote a book 2 years or so ago, somebody wrote Wakti Law, and was looking for, in a minute, for something quite simple, presidential speeches. So the first thing, before you get to that, is that a president, for instance, will put a stamp, a vision of his, hers, or theirs, and the intellectual project at the center of PsySSA. To do this, as part of this, I would like to introduce that PsySSA introduced presidential speeches. Formal presidential speeches were in the address in which the president would share with us their project and their vision. And secondly, then and last, this would ensure that we shift the center of gravity. You cannot blame a well-functioning machinery, which is the administration of PsySSA. It works well. And the office has more of institutional memory than the president. As a nominations person, I know every year I have basically to act like a recruitment officer. I have to say, PsySSA needs you in the leadership position. But the president sits for 1 year in office. Of course, they are president-elect and they are past president, but they sit for 1 year. And before they can get to stamp their vision for PsySSA, they have to move on. We have to think about this so as to shift the balance then between the administration and the executive and council of PsySSA.
I think, as the previous two presidents have said, I became involved in PsySSA when it was formed because I was excited by the vision of transformation and development of the science and practice of the discipline that was in place to position it to meet the needs of post-apartheid imperatives in the country. And the vision that was spelled out was something that spoke to me, and I wanted to play whatever small part I could in helping that happen. But again, I took up the presidency in 2000 in a time of conflict, because the transition process that has been needed to help our discipline meet the needs of the country has not always found support among psychologists. And there have been periods in PsySSA's history of considerable conflict and divisiveness in the discipline, and my presidency coincided with one of those, and interestingly enough, it was around continuing professional development. And the AGM at which I assumed presidency at the end of had bouncers lining the walls of the AGM. People may not remember that, but that was the climate in which I came in. So again, when you have that, considerable energy goes into dealing with the issues around it. I think a lot of this divisiveness, conflict, as we've heard, is ongoing, and in many instances does mirror the ongoing divisiveness, conflict, and issues that we still face 25 years into our democracy. Having said that, I think there were a couple of very important initiatives that came into play during the time just before and during my presidency. For me, one of the key things, and this SATS coupon was very instrumental in bringing it to the fore, was that psychology was declared a scarce and priority resource. I think many of us have forgotten that. And that was crucial at the time, because one of the outcomes of it is that at the current time, salaries for psychologists in the state sector are on a par with the medical sector. And this is almost unheard of globally. So this has been a huge push and, of course, was very important for the role of psychology in our developing democracy. Another important initiative that perhaps we've forgotten now is that the previous legal system would only allow psychiatrists to make determinations about the mental capacity of accused. And again, through strong advocacy and leadership by PsySSA, this was changed to allow appropriately qualified psychologists to also be part of this determination, again raising the profile and status of psychology in our country. One other initiative that I think is critical I want to mention is post-TRC. There was a move to ban psychological testing, particularly within the employment sector, because of the way it had been used inappropriately and the fact abused, particularly during the apartheid era. And again, through strong intervention by PsySSA, this did not happen. Although, of course, as you know, the Employment Equity Act does allow it, but it's got to be appropriate and so forth. So the PsySSA has played a very strong role through advocacy in advancing the profile, the status of our discipline in South Africa. And I think we need to remember that. The other thing that was really much at the forefront of my presidency was the international side. When PsySSA was formed, we perhaps forget that one of the initiatives that was very strongly pushed was international engagement, because South Africa was completely isolated because of the apartheid era. And fairly early on in 1996, PsySSA was readmitted as a member of the International Union of Psychological Science. Importantly, in 1999, which was the Congress at which I became President-Elect, it was the first regional conference for Africa that the International Union of Psychological Science had hosted on the African continent. And interestingly enough, it was the first CPD-accredited conference in the country. So that was a big initiative, and then the following year, SATS was elected to the executive of the International Union, and as you say, the rest of history in terms of his trajectory there. But importantly also, towards the tail end of my time as past president, was the bid for the International Congress of Psychology, which we won in 2004 at the Beijing Conference, and of course, you all know, was held in 2012 and gave great impetus to our discipline again in South Africa. So that international trajectory has also been important. What perhaps people don't also realize is at various junctures, other countries have approached us, looked to us for how to navigate difficult situations. APA, when they had the Hoffman Commission and issues around human rights abuses there, reached out to PsySSA leadership to ask how we have navigated some of the issues. So we have also been seen as an organization that does have a role to play internationally in dealing with some of the imperatives in which the world is involved. And I think we continue to have an important role to play there. In terms of going forward, I just want to look at, if you look at your annual report, it talks about building, the tagline is building a unified, relevant, and responsive psychology. And I think Garth spoke about the perilous times in which we find ourselves. This is particularly important at the moment. We have a country and a profession with high levels, as Garth said, of trauma, there's pain, there's anger. There are a lot of issues that need to be dealt with. And PsySSA and our discipline need to find ways to be at the forefront of this. One issue that I'm sorry to say for me is not as prominent in this conference as I believe it should be is the role of psychology in the national health, in the NHI system. We mustn't forget we've been declared a priority resource. We're important. And we need to make sure, particularly because of the role I think we all believe we can play in helping heal our nation, find a way forward, that we have the right role in the NHI, and that needs to be front and center, not least of all because the bulk of psychologists are in professionals, and this is their lifeblood. So that, for me, is terribly important. And, of course, with the NHI, it's WHO's universal health coverage, but it's also universal mental health coverage. That's health coverage for mental health that is affordable for all, which I think we all believe in, and we now have to find a way to embrace and make sure psychology is central to that. And then, of course, the other one is being responsive to the current needs of our country. So we've heard all about it, the xenophobia, gender-based violence, and so on. The statement is a start, but we need to find ways to help address these and help our nation move forward. Thank you.
The current medical bird was used as a symbol. The human anatomy is distinct in that it would be abnormal for me to turn my head 180 degrees back. However, we have understanding and memory of what brought us here. And I would be remiss not to point out a few historical facts. In 1947, when Dirk Malan's party merged with Klasi Havenga to introduce what we now know as the apartheid system. Within weeks, the South African Psychological Association was formed in the heart of the country, Bloemfontein. On the 20th of January 1994, about 100 days or so before, well, more than 100 days before Nelson Mandela was ordained first president of a democracy in this country, PsySSA was formed. The difference? Massive. One was a handmaiden of the ruling politics of the day. We are not. We are decidedly anti-sectarian, anti-racist, and anti-sexist. A few other key milestones. Act 56 of 1974 enabled psychology to become an auxiliary profession under the Medical and Dental Council. Through PsySSA's involvement, we create the Health Professions Council with the Psychology Board on par with the Medical and Dental Board previously counseled, reduced to just another board, equality, and it's referred to the occupational specific dispensation. We won, I think, the other countries is Brazil, where psychologists in the public sector, in designated health areas, earn the same in internship and as registrars in community service, and in any promotional ladder as medical and as dental practitioners, unique in the world. So we have many unique things, but do we use them to showcase what we're about? And do we use them as a point of departure? Unfortunately, because we psychologists, sometimes we tend to navel gaze, and sometimes we look at the confines of our counseling offices, our therapeutic milieus, and we want to bring the entire world into that narrow Procrustean bed of intervention. All around us, things are burning. We cannot bring all those people into our therapy rooms. So there needs to be other responses. arising out of the Medical and Dental Act being allowing psychology to become a profession. In 1976, I think the first registered started. But it's only in 1982 that CASA is formed. And then in 1994, all these bodies give up their identity to form PsySSA. But still, the imbalance in that the profession has been historically white-dominated. 25 years after democracy, it remains white-dominated. How then do we intervene in a country that is 80% African, ethnic African? How then do we justify the kind of, if you're looking at pure racial, ethnic categories created to oppress and confine us to little boxes, how then do you account for the paucity of leadership? How then can we encourage the huge numbers that go into first-year psychology? You know, it's worldwide almost. Huge numbers, first year. It's a weird pyramid, second year, third year, and then it becomes a little pinnacle. It's almost a pyramid scheme. Let me say, in 1983, I came out of Robben Island. It was a battle to get into Wits. Your Wits, Dean. I was taken in only because I could show that I passed the degree with distinction. And I was one of three blacks in the honors class. Following year, chosen for clinical psychology, and told the state does not want to see you in any of the psychiatric facilities. Already, there are people who say, why are you going into this reactionary profession, this bourgeois profession? And in 1994, a man has referred to the Employment Equity Act and the banning of tests and so on. People still look at us as scouts. You come from a bad past. It's about redeeming a discipline which is objectively useful in understanding the human condition. We can contribute immensely to ameliorating suspicions, building bridges where none exist, creating resolution of conflicts which seemingly are interminable and irredeemable. It takes a lot to plan a structure like a bridge. The resources that go into it, the human capital, the tests. It takes an idiot with a bomb to break it. Let us not be the idiots who are out there spewing hatred. Ultimately, we are one. The human being has exactly the same psychological and physical ingredients. The only difference is where you're located, and that's language. And then also belief, whether it's political or religious. But it would be a boring world if we all looked the same and prayed the same. The only other, if it is even a difference, it's the amount of melanin in our pigmentation and maybe the texture of hair. Otherwise, answers be seldom. We are human beings. And don't forget that ICP in 2012 put out Psychology Serving Humanity. 2012. In the last few years, very few major organizations is not talking about humanity. The International Science Council says for science and humanity. Can we not allow the nightmares of the past to continue presenting ghosts in our current and infecting our future. We cannot afford what has happened to some of us, my generation, to carry through to you. You are the future, not only of psychology, but showing a different way of engaging in this era of fake news, social media, where the world is going right because of others. You are that threat to Denmark. You are that threat to Trump. Let not you be the threat in this country, on the southern tip of the African continent. Let's embrace ourselves as one and claim psychology as one.
You can also tell how nervous I'm looking when you go out to such an illustrious panel of the PsySSSA elders. And when you hear them say, in 1976, and that is the year I was born, in 1983 when I was in grade one. Thank you to Shahnaaz and Garth for this opportunity to reflect on 25 years of PsySSSA. As well as to share my vision for the society going forward. I think the panelists before me have all done a great job, as they usually do, and my palms are all sweaty and I'm nervous, but I'm going to go anyway. My first memories of the society were as a student member in 1994, and then volunteering at the first PsySSSA congresses at Wits in 1995 and 1996. The society was just starting out, but the energy of the members and the commitment to psychology was impressive. Just by being a member and having access to the newsletter, allowed me to be part of a community of psychologists in South Africa. It also kept me abreast of developments in the field and exposed me to the broader role that psychology could play in society beyond just fixating on getting into MCAN. So I'm sure the student members can identify with that. Being broke, as most social science students and graduates are, I tried to maintain my student membership for as long as possible. And for Fatima, thankfully, the PsySSSA systems were not as slick as they are today, so I got away with it for quite a bit. Over the years, I have seen the society grow to become a vibrant and well-recognized entity. Certainly, whenever psychology comes to mind at national or international events, PsySSSA is the name and the brand that everyone recognizes. The same applies to government, universities, and research institutions. The society has over the years carved an identity for itself as the nationally representative society for all psychology professionals in South Africa and abroad. PsySSSA's journal, the South African Journal of Psychology, is recognized as the flagship journal for psychology in South Africa and Africa. I can reflect most on the 2016 to 2018 period, having served in the presidency of the society during this period. 2016 to 2018 can be described as the coming of age for PsySSSA, the wonder years maybe, a bit arrogant, but then, you know, the millennial thing. Post the ICP 2012, PsySSSA had grown tremendously in terms of staff, processes, and recognition. The society was by 2016 well recognized internationally and nationally as the voice of psychology. As such, it played host to the Pan-African Psychology Union, and hosted the inaugural PAPO Congress in 2017 under the astute chairmanship of PsySSSA Past President, Professor Anthony Pillay. The Society supported the International Neuropsychological Society in hosting their World Congress in Cape Town in 2017 with Dr. Anne Watts at the helm. The Society's own congresses focused on issues relevant to the discipline, with themes focusing on psychology's response ability and Mandela psychology, the need to listen. The Congress were well attended, with each year in the 2016-2018 period attracting more and more delegates. PsySSSA membership also grew tremendously, mirroring the growth last seen during the early years of the society. The wonder years are described as such, as a lot seemed to favor the society's growth. The society had obtained its own premises in Parktown, Natal. It boasted a newly revamped and contemporary website that matched the chic and professional look of the offices. PsySSSA went digital, and two new publications joined the society, the African Journal of Psychological Assessment, and the online readings and research methods. In keeping with the digitization initiatives, the Congress continued to use an online submission system inherited from the ICB 2012 and enhanced this annually to suit the society's needs. Membership registrations and renewals went paperless to a seamless online system that offered the membership benefit of a listing in the virtual CISO directory amongst the various membership benefits listed in your Congress program. The Society released a number of media statements on core issues affecting the nation's psyche and was amongst the organizations to highlight the injustices and human rights violations at Life as a Domain. The Society contributed to requests for amendments to the Criminal Procedures and Child Justice Act, as well as the NHI, amongst others, during this period. The Society adopted the nearby Roseneath School as its social responsibility project. It saw sponsorship and member support to assist the school in setting up a library. 2016 to 2018 can also be described as amongst the more challenging times for the profession and the psychological society. The scope of practice for psychologists was at the core of a court case against the Professional Board for Psychology. In an attempt to assist both parties in the case to move forward, SISA initiated a mediation process with the parties. Whether the society assisted either party is a tale that only history and the parties will tell. Post the mediation, the matter continued in court, leading to a historic judgment on the 14th of November 2016 in the High Court of South Africa, which ruled inter alia the regulations defining the scope of practice of the profession of psychology are declared invalid. Following this, SISA initiated a countrywide process of consultation and engagement to imagine a more relevant psychology. This process canvassed opinion on several informed models for the profession of psychology, such that the professional board may consider these in deliberations on the changes needed for the scope of practice for the country. This culminated in a SISA submission to the professional board that incorporated the views of multiple stakeholders within and outside of SISA, including academics, practitioners, and students, again cementing SISA's position as a national voice for psychology. To date, the scope of practice remains unresolved, despite the three-year period provided in the judgment. Only time will tell the efficacy or not of the SISA efforts in this regard. The 2016-2018 period can also be described as amongst the most volatile and possibly even divisive periods for the profession. The contested nature of the existing scope of practice provided a leverage point for medical aids, with some medical aids choosing not to reimburse educational and counseling psychologists for their services. Despite the core focus of SISA as primarily a learned society, the society consulted with various medical aids in an attempt to reverse this position. Consistently, the companies chose to leave the status quo as until the scope was finalized. Unfortunately, the status quo remains. A second court case influenced the discipline greatly during this time period. The introduction and subsequent removal of Clause D from the Employment Equity Act gave impetus to the need to examine the criteria used to evaluate psychological assessments. And my colleagues have referred to the role of psychology and psychological assessments in the previous dispensation, so you can see why this becomes even more vital. The High Court judgment of the 2nd of May 2017 made it clear that the mandate of the HPCSA is to classify tests as psychological tests or not. Until the Minister has published new regulations with clear and objective criteria for the professional evaluation of tests, the responsibility for quality assurance reverts to registered psychologists and psychometrists, and from our history we know how that can be abused. A working group consisting of representatives from CIOPSA, SISA, and the Association of Test Publishers South Africa collaborated to form assessment standards South Africa. So, Kopano, you'll be happy to know that the CIOPSA relations are mended. This non-profit organization aims to promote the use of psychometrically sound and ethical assessments in South Africa. As such, the first project this group focused on was developing clear assessment review guidelines, and these will be presented at Congress and has already been circulated to members for comment. Amidst these challenges, the Society ensured that it actively worked on activities outlined in the 2015 strategic plan, achieving the goals set for membership, infrastructure, human resources, and growth. 2016 to 2018 can certainly be described as active and eventful. Like any coming-of-age teenager, The period saw the society traverse through the identity versus identity confusion stage. So, I think we're pretty clear on our identity going forward. The new PsySSA strategic plan will ensure that PsySSA continues to grow beyond the wonder years. The society is clear in terms of its identity, vision, and mission as a learned society. While the HPCSA and professional boards serve to protect the public and guide the profession, PsySSA serves as the watchdog. Most immediately, PsySSA needs to look out for the much-awaited revised scope for psychologists, psychometrists, and digital counselors. It needs to maintain the current membership as well as attract new members to ensure the viability and vibrancy of the organization. As a learned society, it has the responsibility to produce guidelines for important issues. For example, recently, the society, together with the Gender and Sexuality Division, produced guidelines for working with the LGBTI community. A lot more of this is needed, particularly as the country moves into the 4IR. The stunning work done by Fatima and her team in terms of liaising with national and international bodies needs to continue. The PsySSA publication should continue as per the normal cycles. Perhaps PsySSA needs to consider the awarding of a bursary to assist a student who shows promise, but who may not have the funds to study. Psychology in South Africa has over the years limited itself to a very narrow view of intervention, with one-on-one therapy, typically in a private practice, being promoted. Over the next 25 years, PsySSA needs to get more active in terms of contributions towards the mental health needs of majority of South Africans. Clearly, the society has an important role to play in the proposed national health insurance. More than that, as a learned society, PsySSA needs to advocate for a more decolonized training of psychology professionals that focuses on community-based interventions to promote public mental health. Social justice needs have to always define the society's activities, as the incoming president says, to exercise of our conscience and leverage our future. Congratulations to PsySSA for the first 25 years, and all the best for the next 25 years. We will be looking on to support the society as it goes from strength to strength. Thank you.
Thank you, past presidents. It feels odd to be calling you past presidents, but thank you, colleagues and comrades. You were actually less governable than we had anticipated you were going to be. That bell didn't ring as much and as persistent, so thank you. We also appreciate the reflexivity and candor with which you engaged with the brief. There is no doubt from what you have shared with us that PsySSA's accomplishments and growth in the last 25 years are significant and also apparent. But we also hear from you the many provocations and caveats that we need to be mindful of as we think about building vision for the next 25 years. Your recommendations about how we do this are also noted. So there are a number of, then your inputs underscored a number of issues that are critical for the society and for South African psychology. But I want to pick up on one as a way of reflecting, as a way of bringing together some of your thoughts. The theme that really has been weaving its thread since this morning's discussions, and that is about psychology in society. In different ways, the past presidents have emphasized that history matters, that of our country, that of psychology in this country, that of PsySSA. And given this, the question is, how then do we comprehend the identity of South African psychology in its current form? I think you've all raised really important questions about the narrow disciplinary scope and boundaries of South African psychology, perhaps psychology in general, and our accountability to society. By implication, you are asking us to think very carefully and critically about how we construct our roles, how we enact our roles, so that ours is not a psychology that is turned inwards, as is often the case, but one that looks beyond the ego politics of disciplinary status and disciplinary privilege. I think this is a really important theme. I heard it since this morning's discussion, and I'm really pleased to see that it has been elaborated on in this conversation.
Thanks, Shahnaaz. I mean, I think that Shahnaaz has pretty much covered it all, and I'm not going to reiterate that. Suffice to say that I think that the insights, the candor, the frankness, the reflections from our past presidents are really food for thought. And I would like you all to give him another round of applause, please. So Shahnaaz has picked up on this relationship between psychological science and society. I want to maybe add one more item to this. And that is a whole set of conversations about organizational form and function. Because it seems to me that what you are talking about in some ways is the relationship between a vision, a strategy, a set of objectives, and the vehicle that is required to operationalize that and to ensure that it is, that it comes to fruition in the best possible way. And so I want you perhaps to put that on the agenda as well as a kind of point around which we can think about some of the comments constellating. At this point, I don't think we're wanting to prime the conversation any further, but we do have 15 or 20 minutes. We're probably going to run slightly over till about 25 to. And we, at this point, want to open this up to the floor for comments, for questions, for engagement with the past presidents.
Thanks, Garth. Perhaps just to respond to two things. One is the first issue about what is it we should be doing as psychologists to take this forward in terms of a number of the visions put forward by the past presidents. At a very simple level, my suggestion would be let's broaden our horizons, our view of psychology. See, I think there are certain areas of psychology, well, the main areas, that is our job, and generally, I think those are well done. We can probably all tweak our jobs and enhance it. We all want to do that. But I'm more concerned about what's outside of that. Let us keep our eyes and ears open to what's going on in the world, but of course, more specifically in our country and our continent. Like some of the examples that have been mentioned by the speakers here. And let's then ask ourselves, can we contribute? Is there anything we can do? And I believe, given our discipline, given the breadth of our discipline, we can contribute on most aspects of human life, children's development. We have so much to give. That's the one thing. The other is just to respond to one of Jason's comments regarding the. Sorry, Jason made a few comments to recall the one that he made. Maybe I must come back to that. Yeah, I think it was one of his last ones. I think it's probably the last point that Jason made. I'll come back to it.
Okay, the question of what kind of psychologist should we be? I think we have no option but to be. We are as individuals. First of all, let's start. And second, to be fully and 100% on alert about our limitations. Not to continue to pretend that we can understand certain languages, certain beliefs, which are completely contrary to our own. Because that pretends exacerbate whatever problems you're supposed to be confronting it. So, in one of the most multicultural societies on earth, easy to find another colleague who should be referred on this patient. But do we do it? Or do we use a translator? And I can understand using tests and stuff like that. But therapy? Intervention? Other intervention? How do you use the third party? What's a confidentiality issue? If you do, you're dangerous. Shouldn't be doing it. Should be referring it to somebody else. I would never dare dream of taking on an Afrikaans patient
with my teacher at the time. It would be absolutely wrong. So it's those kinds of things, self-awareness and awareness of others. And I repeat, honesty, sterling, my way of difference as well. Embrace that difference, not try to impose ourselves in that space. And don't be a block to those hundreds of candidates out there who want to be in this profession, but who are gatekept out of it. And often, it's not a white person blocking you. It's a black person who has learned bad ways from the past. And that's why I gave you the introduction I gave. You know, those people, at UCT, the head of a clinical program at the UCT and the Red Cross Children's Hospital, he called me at the middle of the night after the selection and said, and it was tough, but he decided to take a chance on me. You're one of the nine accepted, and I rejected it. 3 years ago, I met a woman in Singapore, and she said, you don't know me, but when you rejected the place in Cape Town, I got it. Now, selections have been taking place, and I've heard from people in the selection panel, we're still selecting in the old ways. How then do you justify this profession? How then do you keep excellent people out? And how then do you, sorry to say, attack the trap that we've had with those incidents that we've mentioned? Call the spade, not some implement somewhere else. Our selections have failed, let's be honest about it, in the 21st century, we cannot perpetuate an unconscionable anti-human rights dispensation.
Coming on the back of sex, perhaps I just want to add, in terms of the kind of psychologist we need, is one who is able to embrace and navigate the kind of transformation and changes that are happening and need to happen in this country. And picking up on what Jay said, this includes embracing the NHI and ensuring that psychology finds the right place in the whole setup so that we are there to serve humanity in our country. So as psychologists, and this is something I think we've heard today, is something that psychology has not found easy to do over time, and we need to look within ourselves, and perhaps this is something I think PsySSSA has got to help our discipline do, is navigate and embrace the change that is so desperately needed. And this will also ensure the ongoing viability of our discipline in the country. Because I think it was Seth who said, we was quoted, it's a quote I often use, if there is no need for psychology, psychology will die. And if we don't show that there's a need for us in the NHI, there's not really much of a future. So we need to be cognizant of this, and PsySSSA needs to take this on and embrace the change and help us find our place. Thank you.
Look, I must straight away defend the professional board. The professional board actually introduced the new level of PSY at that level of enabling those thousands who come out with a 4-year degree to have some applied, supervised training and play the kind of roles that were designated at the time. I was chair of that board, I know what we created. Then it got lost. In the same way that we had the scope of practice issue, once you enable in a register as a licensed person, there's always this street approach. Well, I've done the trauma, so couldn't I carry on doing something else? You know? And in that heat lies danger because you're incompetent to deal with other problems, so why should you? In the same way, like some people want to do work in what I would regard as the realm of psychiatry and pure clinical psychiatry, psychology, Why would you want to deal with schizophrenia? And entire patterns of disease there, where there are ordinary people that you can engage with and you can see results very quickly, because we're not equipped to actually deal with some of those without medication and everything else. I've been very specific, but without everything else. So you get somebody trained, and they keep somebody who is bipolar. You've heard in the court cases, my bipolar for 19 years, a very senior psychologist. What's happening? You know? So don't ask for something that you're not exposed to. Do what you can, but it's again the power of a guild not wanting new entrants. The world has changed dramatically. The US is looking at a lower level entry, and maybe when the US has sorted that out, we will come to a place here. Because, let me be very frank about it, UCT and WITS stopped that psych process. Now we all regret it, okay? But that's our history. Let's wait for the board, which has engaged the entire profession, engaged all the sectors, to say, let's revisit the current dispensation. And they only have a year in which to promulgate an approach to this to meet our needs. The Boulder model is there, created after the Second World War, the science practitioner model. But it doesn't mean in our context we should be artificial, where we've got communal engagements to do one-on-one only. So let's really not forget where we come from. Let's open up that space. And don't ask the board to do it. We should influence the board to do it, because the board is not made of superhuman beings. They're like us, and they will take our guidance in this matter. So I think this is a wonderful opportunity, given the uncertainty, to propose a model that is very, very different. And I'm saying, watch that space, because I think the board is going to announce, hopefully sooner than later, a very different way of doing it.
If I can just also respond, I think there were two very important points, both related to the B-Site students, B-Site graduates not having jobs. This is a very serious issue, and I'm with you on this. I think we're all with you on this. And probably could just give a little background to that. And really what I think is an opportune time now is for PsySSA. And I would urge you, the B-Site graduates, to put pressure on PsySSA to do this. It's an opportune time for PsySSA to set up very high-level meetings with the Department of Health. Because the Department of Health is going to be, ought to be, the major job creator for that category of practice. It's a very important category of worker. And so I would urge you do that. I say opportune time for another reason, and that is our country is about to embark on the NHI. Very, very important that the mental health profession in general, the psychology professionals specifically, have a place cemented into the NHI. And then just one last point on the NHI, slightly away from that issue, but again, this comes back to the concerns with social justice. We must see ourselves as monitors of healthcare systems and healthcare quality in our country. There are several concerns we have with NHI. One of my concerns is there's just too much authority and power rested very high up in NHI. In this country, whether we like it or not, we have great concern about too much power government, at government level, that is, and corruption, that almost inevitably happens. We know it. We may not want to say it. We know it. So we're all worried. Whenever some new entity is created, we're all in our little tea rooms or corners somewhere talking about, well, who's going to get a tender out of this? Who's going to make money out of this? This is the reality. We mustn't hide behind anything there. And we have reason to. Right now, there are three commissions going on looking into where our taxpayers' money is gone and stolen, etc. So I say this is another opportune time for us to be getting onto that.
So directly, there was a question. Let me respond to a direct question about the strategic plan. Yes, PysSSA has a strategic plan. Worked through and been announced, I think, in this Congress. But I have to say this, I mean, at least in the room, I was part of one of the discussions. In the room, there were a couple of people who were convinced about one of the pillars, which is African centeredness. But I worry that unless the people who are leading the strategic vision and implementing it are convinced about the imperative for an African-centered perspective of psychology in South Africa and the rest of Africa, for instance. And of course, exporting it elsewhere because Euro-American-centered perspective are exported. Unless you're convinced about that, I doubt it will have as much traction as it could have. So I think PsySSA also has to take this up about, you know, re-educating ourselves about the need for an African-centered matrix, a grounding of what we teach, of what we do. So it's in the strategic plan, but we'll see how this is taken up. Can I just say one thing about this? I mean, this is a practical question, and I like what Anthony has just said to the questions around B-side. Because I have been troubled, not just at B-side level, for instance, observing currents around the world about jobs for PhDs, for instance. I'm worried. I tell my students all the time that in this country, unless the higher education system expands to give you jobs, where are you going to find the jobs? So in the training of PhDs, we do more skills other than just the skills of being academics. And this is quite important that, as Anthony has said, that now that you're in this position, Mandela University and other universities, you don't stop here. You've already put it on the table. But you interact with PsySSA, with the executive of the council, about how we find solutions to this. Not just put it on the you know, this is what happened, the board has done this, but now there's a practical problem, but there's practical solutions, how PsySSA and all of us here can support this young people, not so young people, and then elsewhere, to take up their qualifications that they themselves might not have realized would not lead to jobs and a meaningful livelihood. 2 days ago, there was a program. I mean, the B-side is a different category. B's, I think it was a vendor, again, on the University of Limpopo, that there was a qualification where students took up the qualifications, only to find that it was a bogus qualification. And this was done formally through structures of the university. B-side is in a different category, but even then, what you have to do as faculty, as teachers, as psychologists, as the professional body, is to take up this. That, look, you cannot just train people and let them just find their own way to jobs because they came in good faith into this program and we have to do something about them.
Thank you. Thank you, past presidents. I saw more hands, but I'm afraid we're going to have to stop this conversation. We've run into tea, but we encourage you to engage with the panelists over tea. Garth, I leave you to close the session.
Colleagues, I think we can all once again just applaud our past presidents for their thoughts and their comments. I also just want to indicate some housekeeping matters to you. A big thank you to Roy Blumenthal for all his sketching. I'm sure you are all enjoying this on the site. And please do be alerted to your program booklet on page 12. You will see the details of the CPT scanning times. Scanning normally occurs during tea time. And please also be reminded of the cocktail function this evening. The cocktail function. The one for which you have a ticket. So please do join us this evening. We will break for until 4:15. And we will be back at 4:15. Thank you.